Good morning, Victory Church. It's good to be able to gather together again and worship together. You know, there's a lot of things that they say that we can't do, but you know what you can do? You can open up your hearts to Him and receive from Him this morning. Online too. Thank you, Victory Online, for joining us as well this morning. So happy we're here in your homes. Joining me in prayer this morning. Father, I thank you for the privilege of being able to gather and praise you and honor you and glorify you, God. And Father, I just pray, God, that you would have your way today in our lives, in our homes, in this service, God, that you would fill Pastor Chuck to overflowing, God, with your words for your people. And may you be blessed and honored in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, Lord. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. Then I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, oh, all that you've done for me. Oh, oh. Yes, Lord. All that you've done for me. More than I just want you and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. Just search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Satisfied here in your love. is nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. Nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, all my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. Your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing that's better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's it's better than you. There's nothing that's better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing that's better than you. There's nothing that's better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Into gardens, you turn bones into armies, you turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens, you turn bones into armies, you turn but you, Lord, because you are the only one that can change darkness into light. graves into gardens, bones into armor, mourning to dancing. So Lord, we rejoice in you. We find our joy and our hope and our strength in you and you alone, nothing else. So Father, I just pray that you'd have your way today in our homes, in our city, in our church, and be honored and glorified in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
It's good to see people. Wow. You'll never know what a blessing it is to be able to talk to actual people and not just Joy sipping her tea, reading a book at the same time. No, she does. She never did that. In fact, you guys, I need to be careful what I'm saying. I'd like to welcome everybody online. But the first time we did this, the first Sunday we did this, Joyce set up her chair and it was right behind the laptop that I was using to talk on. And I stopped and we had to start over again. I said, move so I can at least see somebody, you know. Yeah. But I'm excited about the message that I'm going to bring to you this morning. I absolutely am. And it's entitled, No Turning Back. Because once you start to experience what I'm talking about today, once you really grab a hold of what I'm talking about, you won't want to turn back and go back to your own life. I want to introduce you to some spiritual blessings that are there for you, and I'm going to remind you of some things, but I want you to also know that what I'm talking about is an ever-deepening message. It's not just that you become a Christian and you give your life to Jesus Christ and you hunger for him a little bit and life goes on. But I want you to know that you start to experience what I'm talking about today. It will radically change your life. You will be different. And you know what? When you become different on the inside, you become different on the outside as well. So God wants to do a real work in your life. God wants to change you from the inside out. But what I'm talking about today too, if you don't realize that these blessings are there for you, if you don't understand what spiritual blessings that God has for you, you probably won't take advantage of what's there for you. So I want to remind you of some things so that you can take advantage of them. You know, it's kind of like I have a credit card, and this is not a promotion for credit cards. But it's kind of like you have a credit card, and I have one of those that you get points, and then you can use your points. I usually, you know, get a few, three or four or five nights worth of hotel rooms that Joyce and I take advantage of on our holidays. But if I didn't know those points were there, I would never take advantage of them. And that's the way it is. If you don't understand and you don't know the blessings that I'm sharing with you, if you don't know them, you're not going to be able to grab a hold of them by faith and go to a deeper, more intimate relationship with our Heavenly Father. So please pay attention and let me give you some advice. If you think, Chuck, you've talked about this for 7 weeks now and I'm getting tired of the message, I just want you to know that I don't care what you've experienced so far, there is more for you. There is more for you, especially in this realm. There's more peace, there's more freedom, there's more intimacy with your Lord. God wants to reveal himself to you. And you know what's really cool is that God has already imparted these things to us. I think so often we beg and we plead God to do some things in our life. But you know what? He's already done them. You know, he's already done them. He's already given these things to you. You just need to know that they're there, and you need to take advantage of them through faith. And your life will never, ever be the same. How many of you want a different life? A third of you. There's more for you. There's more for you. Don't say that you already know these things, but pray and ask God to open the door for you to experience these incredible things. I want to look at the book of Ephesians today, and I'm probably going to look at the first part of Ephesians. And then I was reading chapter 3 for my regular devotions this week and meditating on those. And there's a lot more blessings that just came alive to me. But the first part of Ephesians, and Paul regularly does this in his books to the churches, what Paul does is he tells you what Jesus Christ has done for you. He tells you how you're adopted into God's family, etc., etc., etc. And he also says, let me remind you of these things, even though I've told you about them before. So that's what I'm doing. I'm reminding you about these things. And then let these things take you to a whole new place. Anyways, I didn't finish my thought. The first part of the book, Paul talks about the spiritual blessings that actually turn into physical blessings as well when you pursue God and let him change you. But then he talks about practical things, about how we should live. And I think so often as Christians, what we do is we focus on how we should live, and how we should live is important. But Paul talks about the spiritual things first, because when you're changed spiritually, the physical things just naturally seem to follow suit. So, not that they're not going to take some effort and energy and you're going to be uncomfortable. I'm not saying that. But when you get down who Christ has made you to be, the blessings that he's given you, it changes who you are. And then the last half of the book usually is about how these things are applied to our life. So, this morning, it's more spiritual blessings. Look at what he says in Ephesians chapter 1, starting in verse 3. He said, every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realm has been lavished upon us as a love gift from our wonderful heavenly Father, the Father of our Lord Jesus, all because he sees us, get this, wrapped in Jesus. Your heavenly Father sees you as being wrapped in Jesus. Now, let that permeate your mind for a little bit. And then it said, this is why we celebrate him with all of our hearts. You see, we need to see that when we invite Jesus into our life, when we decide to become a follower of his, he has lavished upon us, he's already lavished upon us these great and wonderful things. This is not about us begging God for something. He's already given them to us. Look at what the Apostle Paul says. The first point I want you to look at is found in verse 4. It says that we're chosen before the world began to be holy and blameless before him. How are you made holy and blameless? And yes, it does depend on your lifestyle a little bit, but how do you become holy and blameless? You understand what Jesus has done for you. This is all about Jesus. He predestined you to be in Christ, and your heavenly Father sees you in Christ, wrapped in Jesus' presence. If you can get a hold of that, if you can get a hold of this, things will start to fall into place for you. When you understand that God actually imparted his holiness to you. My second point is found in verse 5. It says, it was always in his perfect plan to adopt us as his delightful children. Turn to the person beside you and say, you're a delightful child. How many of you would identify yourself as a delightful child? Two people. And I'll talk to you guys after, because let's get your... No. Reality is, though, reality is, isn't it, that God has made us as delightful children. God's plan was for you to be a delightful child of His, and you are, because you're wrapped in Christ. My third point is in verse 7, since we are now joined to Christ, we've been given the treasures of the redemption by His blood, a total cancellation of our sins. Total cancellation of our sins. Total cancellation of our sins. I think all of us have pasts that we're not proud of, except for maybe the two people that raised their hands before. But God has totally canceled our past when we enter into Jesus Christ. When you think about that, and I think about the things that I've done wrong in life, and I think about those regrets that I have, those sins I've committed, those mistakes I've made, and then to understand that there is a total cancellation of those things because of what Jesus has done for me, it's just mind-boggling. The fourth point, in verse 8, it says this superabundant grace is already, this superabundant grace is already powerfully working in us, releasing within us all forms of wisdom and practical understanding. This supernatural grace is already working in us to give us all forms of wisdom and practical understanding. Isn't that incredible? Verse 11 says, before we were born, He gave us our destiny. You were given your destiny before you were born. And I think sometimes we think it's going to be hard to enter into our destiny. I think sometimes we think, well, I've messed up, and God's destiny for me, it's an impractical thing, and it's never going to happen. I want you to know that God's destiny for you is hard to miss. I think the only way that you can miss God's destiny for you is if you deliberately rebel against God, but it's always there, and you can come back, and you can be the person that God has chosen you to be, and you can have the influence on the world that God has chosen you to have. Remember, there's total cancellation of your sins. So God has something new and important and special for you. And you know what? It doesn't even matter how old you are. Some people here accused me of being as old as a dinosaur. And I just want you to realize that not that I'm pointing at anybody, I just want you to realize that I really take offense at being called as old as a dinosaur. On public media, believe it or not. But God gave us our destiny. God gave us our destiny, and it's actually hard to miss the destiny that God has for you, especially when you start to get the spiritual blessings that God has for you. It's even harder to miss your destiny. Look at verse 13.6. It says, we've been stamped with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. You've been stamped with the seal. You're God's. The Holy Spirit is stamped on your forehead. Or use your imagination. The Holy Spirit isn't stamped on your forehead, but there's a seal stamped on your forehead that claims you as Jesus. Verse 14, my last point in this series, he says, He's given to us like an engagement ring is given to a bride. So God has given us an engagement ring, a spiritual engagement ring that says that we are betrothed to. Isn't that incredible? As the first installment of what's coming, He's given us our hope promise of a future inheritance. And that is so true. When Christ comes back, or I don't have all of the theology figured out, to be honest with you. When we're with God forever, that is going to be over the top overwhelming. And like I said to the first group this morning, what God has for you, his destiny for you, is not you floating on clouds like the old cream cheese commercials used to say. You know, to me, that's more hell than it is heaven. But I want you to know that God has a plan for you far beyond this lifetime. And when we die, it's going to be there for us, and it's more than we can even think or imagine. But I want you to also know that you can enter into this starting today. You can enter into this today. This is not sometime in the future you're going to be blessed, but this is today you can be blessed. And as you study Scripture and look at the things that God has already done for you, and then think about what that means for you, it will blow you away, and it's here for you now, but with a complete fulfillment when Christ comes back. I'm just blown away when I think about some of these things. It's over the top amazing what God has provided for us now. And you know, we could go on and on this morning, and we could talk about each one of these points, and I could preach sermons, multiple sermons on each one of these points. But I want you to start to think about them and get them deep down into your system. You know, how amazing each one of these things is, how God chose you before the creation of the world. God made you to be a part of his family. And don't think of the church as a whole. I think you miss some of the points if you just think of the church as a whole, that God has these things for us all. But take them individually. You're part of God's family. Imagine mom and dad and two or three or four kids sitting around a supper table. Have that picture in your mind of who God is to you. And how special those times as a family are. Have a picture of that in your mind, and it will take you to a whole other place than just, yes, God has adopted me into the worldwide church, which is true, but you miss some of the intimacy, you miss some of the importance, the life-changing things, if you're just looking at that. God made you to be part of his family. He's given you incredible treasures. He's given you superabundant grace that's working in you. You know, I've talked about a lot of these things over the last little while, and the Apostle Paul is reminding the church at Ephesus. And then look at what he says next. In verses 15 and 16, he says, since I've heard about your strong faith, Paul has heard about these people's strong faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your tender love toward all his devoted ones. My heart is always full and overflowing with thanks to God for you as I constantly remember you in my prayers. The Apostle Paul constantly prayed for some things for the people. And I bet you don't pray about them for yourself, or I bet you don't pray about them for others. But these are things that we should pray about. If the Apostle Paul recorded that he's praying for these things for people, we need to be aware of what he's praying. The first thing is, Paul prays that God would impart to them the riches of the Spirit of wisdom and revelation to know him through deepening intimacy with him. Paul prays that God would impart to the people the riches of the Spirit of wisdom and revelation that come through a deepening intimacy with him. The second thing Paul prays, the light of God will illuminate the eyes of your imagination, flooding you with light until you experience the full revelation of hope of his calling. That is the wealth of God's glorious inheritance that he finds in us, his holy ones. Paul prays that God would illuminate their eyes so they would experience the full revelation of the hope of his calling. And that's for each one of us. Paul prays that they would continually experience immeasurable greatness of God's power made available to us, the people in Ephesus, and to us through faith. It's through faith that we take advantage of what Paul has already given to us. Paul prays these things for people. Like I said before, do you pray them for yourself? How many of you, honest, how many of you pray these things for yourself? One person. You see, if the Apostle Paul is praying this for the church in Ephesus, we need to be praying these things for ourselves. We need to be praying that God would open the eyes of our heart so that we could have an ever-deepening intimacy, an ever-deepening relationship with Him. And really, that's what we all want. Have you ever wondered why God would give us all of these blessings? Why would God bless you with these blessings? Trust me, it ain't because of your good looks and charm. Why would God give you these blessings? I can't hear what you're saying. I'm sorry. Don't get ahead of me here. I'm trying to build up to something, and you're wrecking my thing, okay? So maybe just, no, I'll shut up. Oh, okay, good. The rest of them didn't hear it anyways, and I know the people online didn't hear it, so we're good. But you know, sometimes I've wondered, to be honest, why would God choose me? Why would God choose me? And it's not because of my great looks, and it's not because of my talent and my abilities. Why would God choose me? And to be honest, you know, why would God give me a heart that would respond to Him? Why would God give you a heart that would respond to Him? And then not only that, but why would He give you all of these blessings? Why would God open the door for you to achieve real intimacy with Him? Well, I was going to lead up to this point. But in Ephesians 1 verse 19, I just love the way this translation puts it. He says, then your lives will be an advertisement of this immense power as it works through you. You see, when we start to experience these things, then our lives become an advertisement of what a person's life is like who follows Jesus Christ. God wants to use you as an advertisement. You know, they have open houses and new homes, you know, especially new homes, open houses, and everything is so beautiful in the homes. And of course, they're trying to get you to buy them. But God wants to use you as an example. God wants to use you as an open house for other people to see what He can do in a person's life. That's what God wants to do with you. God wants to use you as the demo car that the dealership lets other people drive. God wants to use you as an advertisement of what He can do. So God gives us these things obviously because He loves us and because He wants to have a real sense of intimacy with us. But even more than that, God wants to use your life as an advertisement. You know, we think that we're supposed to be evangelists and we're supposed to talk to other people and we're supposed to do all of these things. And of course, evangelism is important. But you know the greatest source of evangelism, what it is you living the life you having the intimacy with God that God wants you to have. Then your life will be a real witness to other people. Then your life will be the example. You know, the children of Israel, right? Why did God choose the children of Israel? He chose them because God wanted to show the world what a nation who served God would be like. And in the same way, God wants to use you so that you can show your family, your friends, the world, what a relationship with you really is like. Of course, evangelism is important, and of course, talking is required, but I think we get in a dither. Well, man, I don't want to stand on a street corner, or man, I don't want to bring up conversations, man, you know, all of these things. Relax. Just relax. The pressure's off. Just be the person that God has called you to be, and out of that, doors will open for you to talk to other people and to experience other people. Can I have more water, hon? I'm not sick, but occasionally for my voice, I do need this. But in the time where it's a sin to even clear your throat, bear with me, okay? Your life will be an advertisement. Look at what Paul says in Ephesians 1, verses 22 and 23. He says, and he, that's Father God, put all things under his feet. That's the Father God put all things under Jesus' feet. And he gave him, that's Jesus, to be the head over all things to the church. So basically, God has appointed Jesus to be the head of the church. And then it describes the church. It describes us here this morning and the church around the world as well, too. It says, which is his, the church is his, that's Jesus' body. The church is Jesus' body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. That's the church. Did you understand that? I didn't the first time I read that. I had to meditate on that verse and understand what it's really saying. You see, God appointed Jesus to be the head of the church, but Jesus went back to heaven, and so now the church is literally and figuratively Jesus' body here and now on the earth. And I've talked about how God gives us individual blessings. You know, God has made you to be special. There's nobody who has your mixture of gifts and talents. There's no one who has your experiences in life that has molded you and brought you to this point. No one else. You're unique. And God has unique things for you. But you know what? That's true of each one of us. And we all come together in the church. We all come together in the church, and we function as Jesus' body. Yes, you can have your intimate relationship, but you're still not getting the wholeness that there is that we can have with Jesus. But when we come together, when we come together as a church, we then have a more complete picture of Jesus' body. We have a more complete understanding of what God is, and we can represent him. You know, don't ask me to fix cars. Don't ask me to put this service online because it ain't happening. But you know what? There's people here who have done that. There's people here who have those talents. There's people here who can fix cars and do a good job. And there's people here with different spiritual gifts, you know. The scripture says that God has given to each one of us a spiritual gift. God has given each one, but it's when we come together, it's when we come together that God can use us. It's when we come together that we have a more complete picture of who Jesus really is. And you know, how many of you, don't raise your hands, but how many of you know somebody who's a little quirky? I said, don't raise your hands, you guys. And don't point at anybody either. That's not acceptable. Husbands and wives are pointing at each other. Yeah. Now there's a lot of pointing going on. But you know what I found in life? The person who's a little bit quirky, which is all of us, by the way, but the person that you think is a little bit quirky is the one that God wants to use to bless you. I've seen that so often in church. The person who just seems to be a little bit different has so much to offer the church as a whole. And we need, for all of those people that are feeling bad because somebody pointed at them right now for being quirky, God has made them to be very special. And you need them. You need them as part of His body to go all of the way with Him. Does that make sense? You know, about 20 years ago, I had a guy who came to church. I was pastoring in Claire's home at the time. There was a guy who came to church, and I kind of got a kick out of it because he came and he was telling one of our leaders, he just split up with his wife. He was telling one of our leaders that, you know, if I could just get my wife to see where she's wrong. If I could just get my wife to see where she's wrong, then we could get back together and everything would be fine. But you know what? Before long, he changed his attitude. And I think one of the things that really helped him to change his attitude was the fact that he had a vision from God. You know, visions from God can mess up your thinking sometimes. And he saw his... No, in the vision, he had been given an incredible gift. The value of the gift was overwhelming. What was inside the packaging was absolutely amazing, but the packaging was bad. The ribbon had fallen off. The paper was torn. And you know what? He realized that that gift was his wife. And he was missing the gift that his wife was to him because he didn't like the packaging. I wonder how many husbands and wives are like that. They're looking at the torn packaging, and in looking at that packaging, they're missing the incredible treasure that God has made that person to be in their life. You see, and that's true for us as a body of Christ. God brings us all together, and we're His body. But you know what? We look at other people sometimes, and we see their quirkiness, and we think, ugh. And we write them off, and it should never be. I have learned, and I've learned this the hard way, that the person who seems a little bit that way, that doesn't quite seem to fit in to the body to start with, I've seen how important they are to the body. And if you can overlook a person's difference, then you will find out what an incredible blessing they are. You know, we need to, I've been hammering this into you, how much God loves you. I want you to see how much God loves you, and that's important. But you know what? The person sitting beside you, or the person sitting across the room from you, or the person who's watching online as well as you, you need to see that God loves them the same way. And when you can see that God loves them the same way, then it's easy to overlook another person's quirkiness or faults, or however you want to put that. God cares about the other person as much as He cares about you. So, you know, like it says in Proverbs, the person who looks down on the poor forgets their maker, or forgets who that person is. And that person is special to God. So we need to be careful how we work with each other, how we look at each other. We are Jesus' body on the church, in the church. The church, I'm trying to do two things at once. I'm trying to find my place and my notes here, and I'm also trying to talk, which is never a good thing. God wants to use you. God wants to use the church. And it's the church that gathers together. I know some of you are nervous because of the coronavirus, and some of you are watching online, and hey, I'm not trying to convince you to do anything that you don't want to do. Honest. Because I want you to be safe, and some of you have respiratory illnesses or whatever, and you need to take it seriously. But you know what? Staying at home and watching on TV is not nearly as effective as getting together and experiencing each other. Like, didn't Dave and the worship team do an awesome job this morning? And you can't tell me that sitting at home and watching that on TV is nearly as effective in worshiping the Lord as being here together. We need each other. I saw on Facebook somebody had said that, you know, they don't ever need to go to church again because there's a million churches that they can watch. And you know what? I say something really spiritual to that. I say hogwash. And I am not saying that because I'm trying to convince anybody to come to church. I don't mean that. I'm just talking about facts that you miss out if you're not regularly meeting with other people. We need each other. We need all of us. And all of us add something to this incredible thing that God has for us as well. So let's enter in. And you know what? If you've never... God has so much to offer you. God really has so much to offer you. And there's amazing things that God wants to give to you. But it begins with you deciding that you're going to be a follower of Jesus Christ. It absolutely begins with you saying, I want Jesus to be a part of my life. And I decide that I'm going to be a disciple of His. I've decided that I'm going to do the things that Jesus did. And some of those things are fasting. Some of those things are getting away by yourself. Some of those things are just shutting up for a while. Getting away by yourself. I need to do that occasionally, and I should do it more. But just to get away by myself and spend time with God. And you know what? If you're a wife or a husband with kids, you know, take a shift and let somebody get away, even if it's for a few hours. There's something about just not talking and being there with your Bible and without an agenda that opens a whole new world for you. Anyway, I'm getting off track here, but what I want you to see is there's a whole world awaiting for you, and it begins with giving your life to Jesus Christ. And you know, this isn't rocket science. This isn't really hard. In Romans 10:9, it describes the process. It says, if you publicly declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will experience salvation. So publicly declare, that's tell somebody else, publicly declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that Jesus is who he says he is, that Jesus was raised from the dead, you will experience salvation if you embrace these truths. And I want to lead you just in a simple prayer right now, because I want you to start this journey for these incredible treasures that I've talked about this morning. Incredible spiritual treasures that are there for you. So just say a simple prayer like this. Lord Jesus, I invite you to come into my life. I declare that you are Lord. And I do believe that you were raised from the dead. And Father, forgive me for what I've done wrong, and I want to be a disciple of yours. And just like that, God will change you. And you can begin this incredible journey, but it's a journey. We make a mistake when we think we invite Jesus to come into our life and then zam, pow, we're different. And to a sense, that is true, but also understand that it's a process. And it's a process to develop intimacy with our Lord and Savior. So I would encourage you to begin this journey this morning. So thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much for coming. And we just want you to experience more of God. That's the heart of our church. Joyce is going to come in just a moment, but let's bow our heads and pray. Father, I thank you. I thank you that you're so awesome. And I thank you, Father, that you've opened the door for us to really experience you in life. Father, may each person here and may each person who's watching, Father, may their heart be open to see what you have made available to them. We just thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Joyce?
Well, praise God. I hope you all feel real special. You know, there's so many treasures that God has for us that we need to tap into. And so I'm looking forward to delving deeper into that stuff. And so we're special and we're blessed and we're quirky too, I guess. So that's okay. God is good. So a couple announcements this morning. First of all, the Zoom meetings, we're continuing those. There's Zoom Kids this afternoon at 1 o'clock with the young ones and 1:30 with the older ones. You can sign on and be a part of that. There's more information on our website for that, so check into that. Tomorrow night, we have Monday night prayer, 7 o'clock here at the church. You need to email us and let us know if you're coming. We're only allowed 50, but it would sure be fun to have 50 here. So come and be a part of that. Last week was just a really special time. And also, you've heard about this before, but we've got VBS starting this year at, we're starting on Father's Day, June the 21st, Victory Ninja Warriors. And so we've got a video here that's going to explain and give you all the details.
This is Teacher Leanne from Victory Church of Red Deer. We are doing our new VBS program this year, Victory Ninja Warriors. We are so excited for everyone to join us online. If you register, you get badges from us and cool stuff throughout the whole summer. Our program starts on June 21st and goes through the whole summer. You can kick butt all summer long with Victory Church of Red Deer.
Hi, my name is Michaela. I've gone to this church my whole life, and I'm 10 years old.
I am Master Steve Grandesa, 5th and black belt of Gansu, the Philippines. It's a Filipino martial arts founded by my grandfather, Grandmaster Casimiro Chinky Grandesa.
What advice would you give someone? Why do you think they should join?
Because it would be physical and you could learn a lot more about Jesus and the armor of God and that kind of stuff.
And what are you hoping to see this year? What do you think would be, if you could pick, what would be the most awesome thing this year, what would it be?
Being taught by an actual ninja instructor.
A little bit about what we're going to be doing every Sunday. We are going to play some online games together. We're going to do some martial arts training with Master Steve. We're going to do some Bible memory verse memorizing. We're going to sing some worship songs, and we're going to have so much fun together.
So what do you think you should get badges? What do you think you should earn when you're in this?
I think a little pin would be cool with, like, since we're doing the theme on Armor of God, I think a little pin with, like, the different armor of God stuff would be on it, and that'd be really cool with like a ninja face.
First and foremost, it's one thing is trying to help the community as well as serving God, and most especially the kids.
Do you think that families could be involved in this?
Yes, of course. I always say, if we have a saying like, the family that prays together comes together, the family that trains together, I mean, kicks and punches together as well. So those are the things that I really would want to share, because martial arts, Gansudo, is basically one good family bonding experience where, you know, they can relate and help each other, and of course they can also protect each other.
We could all be involved in it. The kids could be involved, the parents could be involved.
And do you think you're going to be able to get your mom and dad to do this with you?
Yes, maybe.
I think it's going to be really exciting. So this year we're going to be learning about the armor of God.
Yeah.
And in that it's going to be called the Victory Ninja Warriors. And so that came from your inspiration. So
yes.
Thank you. And in that we're going to invite a ninja master to come and to do all the ninja teaching for us. So how do you feel about that?
That's really cool, and I'm really excited for it because it would just be awesome, and it's cool to get it from an actual ninja teacher.
And so what are you hoping to get out of this year's Vacation Bob School?
I want everyone to have fun and be physical, but I also want them to learn more about Jesus.
You guys can have so much fun with your families in your own home. Nobody is watching, so you can all do the moves together. This is something that's gonna bring us all together closer as family units. I hope you all join us and have an awesome, awesome time at the Victory Ninja Warriors.
Well, that sounds like fun, hey? I trust you'll all sign up for that. Good job. I was glad they didn't ask if Grandma and Grandpa were going to get involved in that. I can just see myself doing one of those kicks. I might never get my leg back into where it's supposed to be, but whatever. But anyways, that's going to be a great time, and I encourage you all to be involved in that. You can register on our website, vcrd.ca/VBS2020. So you could just go to the website, and if you register, that's how you'll get the badges and be a part of that. So yeah, that should be fun. We also are going to receive an offering this morning, and it's just so good to be able to honor God with our tithes and offerings. He's been so faithful to us and looked after us. So there's offering envelopes there in front of you, and there's the offering boxes, one at the exit door here and one at the information center. The debit machine will be available at the information center, and obviously there's other ways to give through mobile giving and e-transfer, etc. So thank you for being so faithful to that over the last few months, and we just want to continue to give God the glory because He is so worthy. There's a verse I read this week in Philippians 1 verse 6, a familiar verse, but it just sort of jumped out at me. It says, I pray with great faith for you. This is Paul believing beyond a shadow of a doubt that he was fully convinced that the one who began this glorious work in you will faithfully continue the process of maturing you and will put his finishing touches to it until the unveiling of our Lord Jesus Christ. We can trust in God. All these treasures that Pastor Chuck talked about earlier, these things are all for us, and God is working in us, and we can believe that. And so as you give of your tithes and offerings this morning, just remember the faithfulness of God, and we can just give to Him out of hearts of joy. Let's just close with prayer this morning. Father, we thank you so much for your goodness. Thank you for that message this morning. And I just thank you, Lord, that you'll seal those words in our hearts, and we will walk in the fullness that you have for us. Take hold of those treasures you have for us and pray like you prayed, like the Apostle Paul prayed, Father, so that we could truly experience all that you have for us. Thank you for your goodness to us, Lord. And I pray even for the tithes and the offerings. Thank you for blessing your people in so many ways, Father, that we are able to give back to you and to make a difference in our community and the different areas that we are involved in. Thank you again so much, Lord. And I pray for this people that you would just go with them this week, Father. I pray that you would bless them and keep them, Lord, and that they would just shine for you in every area. Thank you, Lord, for being our God, our Savior, and we just look forward to serving you this week in Jesus' name. Amen. So God bless you. Have a great week, and we will catch up with you next week. Thank you.